So I'll kick things off by saying you may have noticed that something big happened this week, and then we'll all hold up our switches, and Chris is going to make that
Okay.
terrifying face, and then we will be good to go. He could be like, "I'm David Pumpkins. I'm getting questions.
Any questions? I'm David Switches. Any questions?"
Need all three there. That was
Just
juggling
he'll
one
strap
on
one
his
on his
head.
forehead and he'll hold two up and look great.
That'd be amazing. I'd do that. I want to wear them like Princess Leia buns. Help me, James. You're
Oh
my
my
only hope.
gosh. You guys ready?
Oh my gosh.
What's up, everybody, and welcome to the show. This is episode 67 of the Life of Gaming podcast. My name is Jamie, and I'll be your captain on this cruise of video game awesomeness. And you all know my co-host, the man with the beard and a nice blue jacket to match his nice blue headphones, Mr. Josh Brant.
What is up, sir? Whirlwind of a week.
Absolutely. We've all been kind of busy. We've
Yeah,
all been
just a little bit.
kind of busy. But
Yeah.
the other man on our show to kind of kick things off, gonna be rolling kind of fast today. We got a lot of stuff to cover. The other man with the beard, Mr. Chris White.
Hello, James. Hello, Josh.
Hello, sir.
Now, I
Happy
must say,
day.
there's a reason we've been very busy this week. And if you're watching the video version, we've all been playing a little system known as
What?
Wait, right.
Oh, my bad.
A
Wow.
little system
Yeah.
known as the Nintendo Switch. Now,
Size comparison.
that's why you did that. Thank you. Good idea.
Bro, if that makes you feel
if
better.
you're on, if you're listening, watch the video because I held up a Vita.
It was hilarious. He's
It
so funny.
wasn't
It's
near as
great.
funny as he thinks it was.
Oh, man. Okay, I guess the first thing we should start off with before we ever get into what we've been playing. You guys, you both had your switches sent to your houses, right? Like you didn't have to go out and search. You don't do anything crazy like that, right?
Correct. That is correct, James.
It was just here,
right, which is
courtesy of
great.
Batman.
Now, I will say my switch, it was I had a very interesting switch weekend because mine was supposed to arrive on Friday, right? And it did. But it didn't arrive till like 4:30 in the afternoon. Everybody on Facebook, everyone's out there playing it, and I'm just like, you've got to be kidding me. I'm just waiting. I'm like, where's my Switch at? And it finally showed up. But the
You were
other
sweating bullets, man.
I'm like, it's not because sometimes our UPS is late or show up the next day, and it's annoying. So I'm like, it's got to come today. And it did, thankfully. I'm very happy about that. But Thursday night, my brother-in-law Matt, he's been on the show for a very long time, before Chris hopped on, because Matt's got a busy life, being a teacher and all that stuff and having a kid. So, he's pretty busy most of the time. We'll have him back on the show, I promise, when I can finally get him on the show. But Thursday, he's like, "I want a Switch." And I'm like, but he didn't
Just
pre-order one. And
randomly.
he's like, "I want a neon Switch." And it's like, oh my
No.
gosh. So Friday morning, I call, or I guess Thursday morning, I call GameStop and say, "Do you have any Switches?" And they say, "We've got four." And I'm like, okay. And they said, "Well, here's the plan. Around, I think it's at about 6 o'clock, they're gonna start letting people line up, get in line, and people could order their accessories and get all that stuff done. So at midnight, people could just walk in and pick up their stuff." I'm like, okay, great. But then I'm like, okay, they only got four. Let me call, the other local GameStop. So I called them, and they're like, "We have. We don't know." Well, they told me, "We don't know how many we have in stock. They won't tell us." So I'm like, well, obviously they're lying.
Yeah,
But the
of
other store
course,
knows.
of course.
But this was at like, I think 3 o'clock-ish, getting close to the afternoon. They say, "We already have somebody lined up." And it's like, oh my gosh. So then I call Matt. I'm like, "Dude, they've already got people lined up. What do you want to do?" Because originally we weren't going to go until like 7:30, 7:45-ish, closer to open
No,
time.
no.
And he calls our local GameStop and they say, "Well, we got two people outside." And this is like 4 o'clock. And I'm like, oh my gosh. So, pretty much, long story short, we both bundle up and head out. Because it's snowing. It's 30 degrees and blowing snow like crazy. So we show up, and there's two other guys there. And the funny thing was, they're only getting one Switch because one of the guys like, oh, I'm just here with my friend. He's picking one up. So there's only technically one guy in line. So Matt and I get in line. These guys are really cool. They're really nice. They actually came prepared. They had blankets and chairs for everybody. It was great. And so, you know, we didn't really have to bring much of anything. And so we sat down about 4:30. And the one guy only wanted a gray Switch because they only had one neon and three gray. And it's like, oh my gosh, that's so awesome. So the odds of him getting the one neon Switch they had, it was awesome. That's so great. Pretty much we sat down at 4:30, about 6 o'clock. I went in because they only had three pro controllers. And they said 6 o'clock can come in and get a pro controller. I'm like, oh my gosh. So I went in, I got a pro controller, super happy about that. So I got my pro controller, and then my wife, you know, she wanted me to come home for dinner. So Matt was already in line. So I'm like, Matt, what do you want? So I ran to the Arby's across the street, got him some dinner, dropped it off to him. And I hopped in my car, went home, ate dinner with my wife, and we watched a show. And then I came right back out. So
leave him in the cold.
Yeah, I left him in the cold with the other two guys. But and then we sat there. I mean, he was there since like 4:30. And I got back because I was there from 4:30 to 6. And then I got back about 7-ish, 7:30. He was there maybe an hour by himself. But then we just sat out in the snow. And by the time I got there, there were three other people out there. I'm like, oh my gosh, this is crazy. So it was one guy and his friend, me and Matt, one guy by himself, and then a father and his son. And so it was like this group of people were all just sitting out in the snow waiting for our Switches.
Chris is sitting in the sunshine.
I know.
Was playing a Switch. it was great. Yeah.
But it was fun. Like the last midnight launch I went to was like an Xbox 360, I believe. So it's been a while. And that was inside because our local Walmart, they let everyone line up in the store back by where they, you know, where you pick up in-store orders. So we were all waiting inside. So it was super easy. But this time we were out in the cold and the snow and we, you know, roughing it. And it was good. It was fun. We had a great time, made a lot of new friends, and it was good. It was great. So I hope, first of all, I just want to say, I hope everybody out there is able to find their Switches.
Yep.
That'd be great. Yep. But okay. There's one big game we're going to talk about. Well, that'll kind of be like a topic of the week. We'll talk about that later in the show.
We've all played it.
Right. But let's kick off with what we've been playing that is not called Zelda. So, Brant, let's kick it off with you, man. What have you been playing?
Okay, well, I'm the only guy that can speak for the other big release, which,
right,
quite frankly, is overshadowed. Horizon Zero Dawn came out on Tuesday. In which day I picked it up. I spent 3 hours that night playing it, loved it, and then I was going to play more this week before Zelda, but guess what happens? My basement floods. Of course. To happen. Where all my stuff is at. And it was because one of my dang kids left the sump pump unplugged. Wasn't a happy camper, but what do you do?
That's right.
It happens. Yeah. So we got all that cleaned up. As you can see, the tiles dried out. These are carpet tiles, so we're able to lay them back down again.
Awesome.
So
now you made your kids
some new furniture.
You made your kids go down there with like a sponge and a bucket, and they had to just soap it all up.
Toothbrushes.
This is your fault. You're gonna learn from your mistake.
No, I come back. I get called. Erica calls me emergency. I'm worried that one of the kids is hurt. So I just go off of work and come back, and then I see my kids sliding with their feet in the basement, unfinished part. I'm just like,
oh no.
They're having a blast while Erica and I are just sweating.
Pool party, man. Pool party in the basement. This is awesome.
So I didn't get to play Horizon as much as I would have liked, but I have to say, man, it's great. All the reviews are true. And, you know, it's no doubt Zelda and Horizon are going to be probably the two game of the years. For barring Prey being the second coming of BioShock,
sure,
or Red Dead Redemption 2 release,
or Super Mario or Super Mario Odyssey. I mean, that's coming.
Yeah,
too.
Yeah, even that. I mean, Mass Effect.
Mm-hmm.
But
Xenoblade Chronicles 2.
What's great about just the combat is just so satisfying. Like, this is actually an open world game where the combat feels good, and it just not generic. Like, it's right. All really good. Like, tying down the mechanical beast. I haven't even seen the biggest ones yet. I'm still fairly early in it because of all that happened.
Sure.
But
how many hours would you say? Like 4, 5, 6? Any idea?
Yeah, I'm approaching 5. And so I'm starting to unlock new weapons and stuff like that. Still fairly early. I've been putting more time into Zelda since I got that. But yeah,
of course.
If you're a PlayStation fan, you need to buy this game and support it because it is fantastic.
Awesome.
And then I'm sure we're going to talk about some Switch games. Right. One other game I have is 1-2 Switch.
Oh, yeah.
Chris has that too.
Yes.
I actually played that on Friday morning because Matt brought it, because he knew my Switch wasn't there yet. So he brought it over and we played it. So that's one game we've all played.
And, yeah. Okay. Yeah. For me, it's not a great game at all. I really don't care for it, but the kids love it. So if you have kids, it's perfect. Like Chris's kids played for hours. Mine played for hours. Mm-hmm. And I had fun playing with the kids, but I don't see myself having fun playing with other people, really. Maybe for like a half an hour, an hour, but then it would be something that would die fast.
Sure.
So now, it's not worth the money, definitely.
Right. Now, did you play the board game version, or are you just picking out random games?
Just random games. They only like certain games.
Right.
He won't play like the baby game. And
what do you mean the board game version?
Yeah, there's a mode in there. I forget what it's called. But you both start. It's actual board. It makes a board game, right? So it's like this, S. And it's got like how many games in it that are like on this board. And as you win, you get to roll this spinny wheel, like in like the life when you like spin the wheel.
Yeah.
And you have between 1 and 6, and you move that many spaces, right? And then you land on a mini game, you play that game. Whoever wins gets the spin, and you kind of like it's actually pretty cool. That's the way Matt and I played the whole time. It's great. I love it.
That's cool. I actually haven't even seen that. I will say that my favorite is. Because we played it with a small group, the team, the left versus right, mode, which is
haven't done really that yet.
Cool. Yeah, so no, like,
I think that's what
like
I was talking about, though.
Huh?
I think that's what I was talking about, though. Right? It's kind of like a board. I mean, it's like an S, and you like kind of work your way up, and you roll after each turn.
Yeah, I'll have to look. I don't remember that anyway. But yeah, I mean, I like that they offer, and they I like the shuffle mode. The shuffle mode is the other thing that I like on it.
Random, yeah.
You can just randomly pick games and play with them. So I mean, some are a miss, but
right, yeah.
They love the sport fight. Yeah. That's their favorite.
Now I will say the games are fun, but the only one where I was like, wow, that is impressive, was the ball count game.
Yeah,
you move around your hand. I'm like, that's really cool. Like, there wasn't any other game. Like, the other games were fun and fine and stuff, but the ball count game was the one where it's like, that's really neat technology.
Yeah, yeah, I agree. I agree.
I like the safe combination one.
Oh yeah, right.
I wasn't expecting that. Was pretty cool.
Mm-hmm.
The rumble is great. It is.
Yeah.
Really good.
Cool.
Yeah.
Anything else you've been playing, Matt?
Nope.
Okay.
Flood cleaning. That's what I've been
I mean, as for myself, before I got my Switch, I think I mentioned it on our last show, I've been trying to get through Mirror's Edge Catalyst, right? So I played that most of the day, Friday, just waiting for my Switch. And I'm on the last mission of the game, but of course my Switch came, so I never finished it. I'm like, forget this noise, and just, you know, threw it off the side.
You'll never finish it.
I will someday when I get back my Xbox. But right now, we're all in the Switch bubble, the hype for the Switch. Yeah. So I'll get back to it. But I mean, it's a good game. I'm really enjoying it. Now I'm almost to the end. In Mirror's Edge, when you get on a good run and you're parkouring through the city and like you just hit every beat, like it's great. There's nothing else like it. It's so much fun. But this one tries to add a whole bunch of stuff in the first one didn't have. So I still think the first one is a much better game. Because they add, like, it's an open world now, so the city is huge. It's like it's too big, right? And they added like these special gadgets. Now you can like pull down walls and you can like give a grappling hook to swing. And like, it's just kind of weird. Like it kind of messes up the flow of your run. And the story's not that great, but when it works, it works really, really well. So if you like Mirror's Edge, check it out. But if you're not a fan of the first Mirror's Edge, don't even bother. Like the first one's much better series. Yeah.
Yeah.
The other game I've been playing on my Switch, as I showed off at the beginning, Fast RMX. I've been super excited for this game for a while. If you're an F-Zero fan or Wipeout fan or any of those futuristic racing games, Check out Fast RMX. It's only $20. Now, if you have it on Wii U, I will say, if you have it on Wii U and you already bought the DLC pack that goes on Wii U, it doesn't add that much more. But I still bought it because, I mean, I loved it on Wii U. I mean, it adds more courses. It adds more modes, more cars. I'm loving it. Like I said, I'm actually going to do a video review for it. It'll probably be up around the same time this is up. So make sure to check our YouTube page out for that. Cool. But, you know, that's it for me. But, Chris, what about yourself?
So, yeah, I mean, pretty much everything I've been doing is on Switch. I mean, outside of Star Wars Galaxy of Heroes, which I play every day on iOS. But for me, you know, I played 1-2 Switch. The problem really for me with 1-2 Switch is that game should have been included. Sure. I don't care what the argument is. I don't even care if you're eating cost on it. And I don't know, you know, we'll probably talk about it at some point. The Switch is doing fantastic. Strong launch numbers, like strong, you know, buzz. It's doing great. We're looking at more of a Wii situation than a Wii U Switch situation, which is what we've been telling you.
Right. Yep.
Yeah. Which is what we've been telling you for the last, you know, month. But I will say one of the reasons that we, you know, I think took off the way that it did was because Wii Sports was packed in.
Sure.
And the fact that I've already showed this to three people with 1-2 Switch that absolutely play the ball game, and they absolutely get it. And then to put it in a room and have like left versus right and that party mentality, like that is the thing that Nintendo needs to sell. Not to us, we're there for Zelda, but that's what they need to sell to the average gamer that got burned, you know, and didn't come back after the Wii. And the fact that they didn't put that in the box just absolutely blows my mind.
I think it will be in the future, though.
I think it has to be. Yeah.
Yeah. And they should have the arts, the corny actors. I know that's more Japanese, maybe they're going for that, but they should have had it more like WarioWare-esque.
Sure. Sure. And it should have. We will get a Wario game in the next 2 years, and it will be exactly like this, but amazing.
It'll be $20.
But, you know, and I don't even mind like the goofy people and stuff. It's fine. Like, we have played this game a lot. This game is absolutely not worth $50.
No, it's
absolutely not a game that I will ever play unless I'm in a room with people. But this is 100% the game. When somebody walks over, I say, you guys got to check this out. Hardcore gamers. But my mother-in-law came over, you know, on Saturday. She didn't know what a Zelda is. But I gave her a Joy-Con and made her milk a cow, and she was cracking up, you know. And that is the power that Nintendo has over people. And the fact that they did not include that just was a huge miss on their part. But anyway, so I'm playing 1-2 Switch. We played a lot of it. The kids absolutely love it. It's hilarious. Yeah. They'll just laugh at each other. They love the samurai and the sword fight one are probably their favorites. And then, of course, my daughter loves the dance pose, which my neither one of my sons understand the concept of at all. Yeah. They just do the exact same pose all three times. It's pretty hilarious. But anyway, so along with that, I picked up Super Bomberman R, which is not a great Bomberman game, but it is one of the best they've had in a while. I mean, I haven't played like a traditional type, you know, Bomberman type game, and it's Bomberman. You know, it looks good. It you know, it's fun. There's a ton of single player content. So, you know, for me, I very, very rarely even play multiplayer games. So when I look at stuff, you know, I'm instantly thinking of how am I going to play this? And so Bomberman has a lot of story content, and it's, you know, it's voice acted and cartoony graphics. It's kind of a, not really comic book style, but it's all 2D art, like hand-drawn art with voiceovers over it. But it's you know, it's cute, it's funny, it's Bomberman, it's fine. I mean, I've had fun with it. That's another game I don't think is worth $50.
Yeah.
Like if I'm reviewing that game instantly goes down a peg because it's not worth the cost that you put into it. That should have been a $30 game.
Sure.
But still, just on the content itself, I mean, it is a fun game and I'm enjoying it. And then let's see, I picked up Shovel Knight. I downloaded Shovel Knight. I went ahead and did the I forget what it's called, but it's the the full, like the treasure, I think it's called Treasure Trove. Yeah, right. Treasure Trove. So it's $24.99 and it comes with all three. So you get Shovel Knight's campaign, Plague Knight's campaign, and then you get the Specter of Torment, which is the new one that's exclusively out.
Wasn't there a fourth one?
There's Shield Knight, but I don't think there's like a. I don't think it's a separate quest. I think you could just play as Shield Knight. I don't know exactly how it worked, but there's only three. There's only three drops so far.
Mm-hmm. Okay. King Knight is supposed to be the next one.
Yeah. So but I mean, dude, Shovel Knight's fantastic. Yeah. I mean, it's great. So that's. That's about it. I mean, I've been playing a lot with the Parental app, which is funny.
Yeah, I did too.
I mean, it's yeah, it's pretty good. You know, we bought two Switches. We bought more than that, but we have two right now that are up and running. So being able to kind of, you know, check in and see what the kids are doing, and then to be able to put, you know, time limits and stuff on it, and I can actually from my app overwrite and power the system off at any time. You know, so if it's like, hey kids, it's time to go to bed, or you know, whatever, time to get a bath, and then like 5 minutes later they're still playing, I can just be like, bloop, I'm sorry. you're off.
Parental lock.
Yeah, so it's kind of cool. I don't know. Do we want to talk? Are we going to get into impressions at all about the machine? Are
yes.
We talk about
yes.
That?
Okay. Absolutely. Yep.
All right. Okay. So then I'll save
that.
Yep, I'll save
put
that.
A pin
so,
in it.
Yeah, so other than that, man, that's it. I mean, awesome. That's my, and then of course, you know, Zelda, which we'll talk about. So cool. That's where I am.
Awesome. Yep. Okay, guys, before we get into all this Nintendo talk, because there's a lot of Nintendo talk we're going to get underway. It's probably a little bit of a longer episode for you guys. Hopefully, you stick around and enjoy it. But real quick, let's hop into the rest of the stuff. So this is what we call Captain's Log. There's just a couple of big news stories this week. First thing, we'll start off with our Xbox news. Xbox announced Xbox Pass, which is going to be kind of like EA Access. We don't really know much about it. It's just going to work kind of like the EA Access Vault, where they'll be, you know, putting games in and out of it, you know, depending. I'm not sure. On EA Access, does it change every month? Or is it
no? So the way the way EA Access works is after a game has been out for so long, it's added to the vault.
Got it.
And the vault doesn't change. So once a game is added, it's just there. So like right now, they have I don't know maybe 20 games as part of the vault, and then you'll just you know, when the next wave comes up, they'll be like, oh, and now, you know, whatever, Madden 17 is part of the vault and you can play it right now. So that's the way that works. I mean, we know some interesting stuff about Game Pass that we can kind of jump into just briefly. So we do know it's going to be $9.99 right. a month.
Yep.
Which is what you pay for Netflix. If you
$120 a year.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
When I look at it that way, it just seems like a lot. But it's two games. It's like two games.
But it is. It's two games. The right. games are $60. So it's two games a year, and you get access to over 100 on a monthly basis. I mean, I think that's a great deal. Yeah. If you look at something like Gamefly is $14.99 a month for one game at a time.
Yeah, right.
So, I mean, you know, it's
not reliable.
Sure.
Yes. It's not reliable. Now, you do get to pick, you know, the games from whatever's being released. So it's more of like a rental service. But it's still the idea is that you have access to, you know, to that game and you're paying a lot of more. You only get one. I mean, you can if you have the space and you wanted to download all 100 games in a month, I mean, you literally could.
yep.
I mean, you got a 4 terabyte, you know, hard drive, and you just want to download every game that offers in the service, like you can do it. Phil Spencer was actually on Unlocked this week.
Yep.
And one of the things that he was talking about is, you know, he did mention, so in the press release, they mentioned that games will rotate out and in, but he made it very clear that it's not going to change a lot. They just had to reach out and make some, you know, some different, you know, business arrangements with companies, and they may only have the rights for a month or so. So you may see, you know, a handful right. of them turn over, but it isn't like, you know, if you have 100 games, you're going to hit the next month and like 75 of those games are going to be gone. It's not going to be that drastic, which, you know, is good. So you'll know you'll be able to have those games for, you know, hopefully, you know, several months at least, so you can kind of play, you know, play through the ones that are there. Yeah. I think it's an absolute slam dunk.
Right.
The other thing is that just like EA Access, They will offer a discount if you decide that you want to buy the game. Were you going to say that?
No.
Okay. Yeah. So I don't remember right off. Is it 20? Yeah, I think it's 20%.
20 or 30.
Yeah. So I actually think I want to say EA Access is only like 10%. But yeah. So like, say that you buy the game and it goes off the rotation. The next time you try to boot it up, it'll basically say, hey, this is no longer part of the pass, but you can buy it at this discounted rate, which is great. So I mean, you're going to get this.
It's going to be kind of like what Nintendo's doing with their virtual console with the paid service, where you get a game for a month and they pull it down and you'll be like, can't play anymore. You don't get
around
discount,
100.
Right? Brant, when we heard this news, you said, this is great. This is what PlayStation Now should have been. Right. Yep.
Really, I'm telling you, they keep pulling these punches with PlayStation, like with the backwards compatibility. There's no excuse that Sony can't get that working on the PS4. I refuse to believe that they can do it.
If they can't change PSN names,
they can do that too. They're just, I don't know what's going on but in this subscription service, the streaming that like you get for over 450 games with PS Now, but the price really isn't right. I think it's
how much?
$18 a month.
Okay.
I forget, 40 or 50, maybe 3 months. It's really bad.
Sure.
Like, now, they really need to rework everything with it.
Right. Now, do you think PlayStation, because I know that Phil Spencer said at E3, we're going to learn more about this pass. This is going to be great. Do you think maybe at E3, Sony's going to come out and kind of revamp PlayStation Now to kind of fit this new service?
I don't know what the... I think that, well, the funny thing is they're doing just fine. They're still selling like hotcakes.
Yeah, they're better, way over
it doesn't
2-1
matter
for Xbox.
What the Xbox One S does now.
Right.
They're going to, they just every month keep nailing it and keep selling better than the Xbox One. So, I don't really see much of a change. They might hint at like a PS5 just because the Scorpio is coming soon.
Sure.
But
now actually, speaking of PlayStation, Brant, moving into our PlayStation news, there's something you wanted to discuss tonight. Some sales going on. What's happening, sir? What's going on the PlayStation front, sir? Our man on the street, Mr. Josh Brant.
Well, James, here on the field. No.
That's a helicopter.
PSVR is
I'm glad you clarified, because I had no idea what that was. It wasn't a helicopter.
PSVR. is actually selling well. Like when I look at social media, you can sort of predict how something is going, and a lot of people were selling theirs to either buy a Switch or something else, but it's actually they're nearing their goal like 4 or 5 months before what they thought, which is they're approaching 1 million sales.
Mm-hmm.
And that's still not a high attach rate for all the PS4s that people own, but it's encouraging to see, because that's a positive sign that they'll keep developing games for it. And, that's what I want. I want to see this thing succeed, because we've heard the guy, Barry Dune, we love you, man, but it's not a gimmick. It's a new way to play. I still believe it's going to work. It's just, like with the Switch being an early adopter, it just needs time to pan out. And so, it's good news to hear.
Cool.
About.
Awesome. I had a thought about PlayStation. I can't remember what it was, but it is good that it's having a good high attach rate. But I mean, it's what? It's $299 for PSVR, right?
No, it's $399.
Okay.
That's just for the base unit. If you want the one with the camera and the game and the... Joy-Cons, the moves.
It's slipping in, man.
It's $500.
Okay.
So cool. It's high.
I was going to say, for being that expensive.
It's a lot to invest in.
Right.
That's the
truth. Being that expensive, selling that many units, that's a good
sign. Yeah, it's not bad. It's way outselling the Oculus and the Vive, and that's understandable because those are astronomical in price.
Right.
The PC you need.
Cool.
So, yeah.
Okay. Well, talking about things that are more our price, Target, our good friends over at Target, accidentally made a mistake. Middle Earth, Shadows of War was accidentally announced.
Yes.
Now, I never
take that back.
I'm trying to remember which company made the game, but they were very quick on it because the next day, I mean, they could have come back and said, "Oh no, we don't want, you know, we," because I'm assuming they were holding this. They were probably saving this close to when it was coming out, but they said, "Here's the release trailer. It's true. Here's the trailer." Boom. Next day, it was on the internet. Everyone knew it existed. So at least they tried to, you know, clean up that mistake the best they could. Because, like, you know, some companies will be like, "Oh no, that's not real. Pull down your tweet." And they just act like it never happened. Now, I never played.
You can't. Yeah.
I never played Shadows of Mordor. Was that a good game?
You never played that?
Nope.
Shadow of Mordor is great. Yeah.
Oh man. Nope. That was one of my top games.
I never played it.
The nemesis system needs to be incorporated in more games. Like, yeah. I'm surprised that didn't. More games didn't take that style.
Now, I know that Shadows of Mordor was on 360 and PS3. Shadows of War is only on next-gen consoles, so Xbox One, PS4. What are the odds of it coming to Switch? I'm thinking if it did, they'd probably remove the nemesis system.
Wait, Middle-earth Shadow of Mordor was on the PS4.
I don't know.
Right, it was. They released a remastered version on Xbox One and PS4, but it originally
It was the base game.
Oh, was it?
It came out for both systems, but buying it for the PS3 or Xbox 360 was not the same. Like, a friend of mine bought that, and the Nemesis system didn't work.
Oh.
So it's basically like a half-baked game.
Sure.
You have to buy it on the current gen.
Yeah, and that's why I don't think Shadows of War will come to Switch. And if it does, it'll probably be like that.
I mean, I think right now we are too early to see things like this come out on Switch. I do think in a year's time that will be the question that we will ask when most games are announced, because I do think we're going to start seeing a lot more companies interested in bringing their games over. You know, I was reading a good interview with Todd Howard, you know, and he was just talking about how resolution, you know, 4K in particular is really kind of a law of diminished returns. Like, it's not, especially in a living room environment with a console, like, resolution doesn't matter. He said what's more important is, you know, like, visual effects, like particle effects and things like that. And that kind of stuff you can scale up and scale down and actually have a game running. I mean, they're bringing Skyrim, you know, which is one of the best looking largest games you know, out there, and they're bringing it to Switch, so we know that that's going to be running on the hardware. We know the hardware can do that. Sure, it may be a lower resolution, it may have, you know, it may have some of their
Borderlands 2 for Vita.
Yeah, some of the particle effects and some of the, you know, whatever lighting and stuff may have to be altered. But I do think, as you know, and from early indication is that Switch is doing well. I think that now that it's out there and people are getting their hands on it, I think that more developers are going to be interested. You know, we talk about even things like Mass Effect, and you guys laugh, and I know that Andromeda is not going to be on Switch. It's just too early. But I absolutely have no doubt that the next Mass Effect game will be on Switch.
You heard it here first, folks. Mark down this day.
The iOS version will be on the Switch.
like I said, I would be more than happy to play a dumbed down version of that game on my Switch, because I'm not even buying Andromeda on the Xbox One anymore. Mm-hmm. I have no interest in playing it now. So we'll see. I think that we will see a lot more games like that. So I do think that we're too early for Shadow of War to even be in that conversation. But I do think we will start seeing stuff like that come over.
Now, I'm still waiting for things like the BioShock collection, because that's just like a remaster. Uh-huh. Right? How amazing would it be if that came to Switch?
Sure.
Or Dark Souls collection.
Right.
The screen looks so dang good. Okay.
We'll get into it. We'll get into it. Actually,
that's all I want to talk about. This is a waste of time.
Today, we're going to have two topics of the week.
I wonder what they are.
So, for our very first topic of the week, I say,
hit it, Chris.
Hit it, Brant.
Switchmas. We're in the switch of the time of our life.
Thank you. That was very beautiful. It was great. It got everybody pumped up. They're like,
this is great. I just can't wait for the switch.
You can't do that anymore, man.
You don't have to wait, man.
Oh, the switch is here. Okay, guys. This little device right here.
In my hand.
What I figured we would do today is kind of talk about the hardware. Because those who are listening to this, watching on YouTube, you may notice, hey, this is up a little late. But I wanted to give us time, because normally we record on Friday nights, right? But I want to give us time to have some hands-on time with this system. Kind of, you know, try out the different control schemes, try out different games, you know, get a whole weekend in with it to really give a good, kind of, not really a review, but, you know, give our early thoughts on the system. First off, before we even start talking about specs and controllers and all that stuff, are you happy with your Switch? Are you happy with the purchase? I guess I'll start with Brant, because Brant, you are the one who said no. And then you're like, Chris, I need your pre-order now.
Yeah, that was a pretty drastic change. I couldn't be happier with the purchase. I'm glad you guys convinced me. I'm glad Bobby, which I recorded an episode, if we ran a Nintendo with Bobby, which you can check out,
awesome.
Which we gloat about the Switch, but... he gave me that push over the edge with Zelda, and man, it has to be the best launch title.
Stop, we're not there yet.
We'll get there, because
we'll head into that. But I'm just saying, that helps a lot with this system. If it didn't have that, then we'd have Bomberman 1-2 Switch.
Right.
But I couldn't be happier with it. The kids love it. Eli wants to play it all the time too. It's just the perfect system for anyone, really.
Yeah,
awesome. And Chris, you know, before we get into different ways we play it, what do you think about the system as a whole? Because you bought three, man. Actually, you bought four, because one went to Brant. So you must is it living up to your expectations? Is it?
Yes. Yes, I did not give away
him
a $300 fee,
like a 20%
that's
fee, right?
Right? That's right. I just
late adopter.
It's funny, like my story with the Switch, you know, started from a very distant place and slowly kind of ramping up to where my hype was completely just palpable. I mean, you walked into a room and it just like it, you just felt Switch. That's just the way.
You're just like, you waking up in cold sweats. You're like, Switch.
My wife was literally like
freaking out.
She was like, I don't want to talk to you anymore. How much longer is this gonna be? Like, just two more weeks. But with that being said, you know, I try not to look at things with rose-colored glasses, and there are some glaring problems that I have with the hardware, with the service, with just Nintendo as a whole. But that being said, the machine absolutely lives up to the hype. Like I absolutely love it. I think it's gorgeous. It's perfect. I mean, the machine is exactly what I wanted from a hardware perspective. It's great. So there are some things, and we can jump in and talk about a few if we get there, but I am overwhelmingly positive on it. And I want to buy another one. I don't have enough hands.
You know they're
all
portable,
just,
right?
Yeah. I don't have to dispose them after I'm done playing them.
Once the battery dies, you open up the trash can, drop it in. Yeah. You're like, gotta go buy another one.
Yeah. So I absolutely love it.
Yeah, and I am so happy with it. Like this thing is great, and it looks so sleek sitting up next to my TV. Like it's so small. And this thing is like,
I can't believe IGN docked their review because of how it
couldn't lay
it
on
sits
side.
On.
Yeah,
that's ridiculous.
This thing is so small, like, and this thing is more powerful than the Wii U, right? I mean, this thing is just it's crazy, and I love it. I absolutely adore this thing. It is great, but What I will say, oh, I can see my reflection in your camera. Nice.
Nice. I mean, you can't see it in the iPhone.
Basically, the size of my phone.
That's crazy. It's crazy. It looks beautiful. It's super sharp. Now, I know Brant and I both got the gray. Chris, you got gray and neon. So you got both, which is really cool.
Yeah. I love. Look at the neon, man. Look at the sharp. I love it.
Now, I will say, I wanted to get all red Joy-Cons on mine. But actually, let's hop into control schemes real quick, because I talk about how great this thing looks, you know, how sharp it is and how beautiful it is, but it just isn't in stock. I mean, I really, two times have I taken this out of the dock and played it, because way I play, I just keep it sat in the dock on my big, nice, you know, 50-inch 4K TV with my Pro Controller, right? And I sit on my couch. There it is right there, the Pro Controller. And I love it. So from the way you guys are talking, before we talk about controllers, just, you know, quick answer. You guys both play it handheld pretty much exclusively, right?
I played once on the TV for like 2 hours on Zelda. And okay. It doesn't have one of those cords that hook into my sound bar. So I don't get that. My TV sounds like crap. Just running through it. So I have these headphones, but nothing wireless, which is a con of this thing. You can't connect Bluetooth headphones, which that sucks. But I've just been playing on handheld mode most of the tabletop at church. I brought this to church, people.
I brought mine today too.
Yeah, it was hilarious because I was sitting. I showed the. There were like maybe 20 plus kids just huddled around. I didn't even know that they knew about this. Yeah. And then I had it in the handheld. I put it on the kickstand and show them. Yeah. I mean, they were just amazed as me.
Did the pastor, because this was in the middle of the sermon, right? Did the pastor stand up and like point fingers at you? And
let me say this. It was great. Because we're recording this on Sunday, you know, 2 days after launch. I walk into to church today and I'm holding this just kind of out as I walk up, you know, like I normally do. And a friend of mine, Matt, across the way, he kind of hollers over and I look over and he's like, he has the exact same case that I have. Nice. And I hold mine up and I'm like, and so we just sit around talking about Zelda. Yeah, it was great. It was great.
Awesome. Now, feel the love. I guess let's talk about control schemes, because there's multiple ways you can play this. You guys talked about tabletop mode, right? So, I mean, you can play it in handheld mode with the Joy-Cons attached to the side, right? You can pop out the little kickstand on the back. And set it down and play it in tabletop mode, or you can play it on the TV. Yes. And when you play on the TV, because I mean, when you're playing in tabletop mode, you can play the Pro Controller, the Joy-Con grip, or the Joy-Cons by themselves. Well, pretty much you can do that anyway, really, except for handheld mode, obviously. But I spent time with Zelda with all control schemes. You know, I tried it with everything. And I just keep going back to that Pro Controller. Like, it feels so good in the hands. I will say the Pro Controller, the sticks are about half the height of, like, 360 Xbox One controller. So the sticks are a little bit shorter, which kind of got some, you know, had to get used to that. But overall, I love it. It's so, so good. Yeah, you can get it. Well, you can't really tell them that. Like, it just feels shorter. It's hard to explain. Maybe it's because I was playing so much Mirror's Edge before I hopped into Zelda.
No, they are. They are a little bit shorter.
It just feels shorter. But I love the Pro Controller. To me, using the grip is fine.
A little shorter.
But the grip is so light. Like, it feels so light. Like, there's no weight to it. And just, I don't know. I like the Pro Controller. That's my favorite way to play, because I'm playing on TV anyway.
I absolutely hate the grip.
Okay.
I hate useless. This is garbage.
So are you playing with the Joy-Cons?
Is the charge grip the same thing, basically?
No. So my sinking charge grip didn't come in. They got delayed. So I'm actually getting it Wednesday. So
are you going to cancel it? You're still going to get it?
No, I'm still going to get it because the kids will play, and I'm not going to buy Pro Controllers for everybody, at least not yet. Yes.
Well, you got three Switches, so you need four Pro Controllers per system.
It's totally fine to play with that.
So we got. I will say that I have played like 99% of the time in handheld mode. I absolutely hate tabletop mode. That's completely useless. The concept is, what if you're somewhere where you don't have a TV? Just place it down on the table. What? No, just hold it. It's the exact same thing. Like, why would you put it on a table? It's a waste of time.
People, like I said, I was at church. I put it down on the table, yeah, and everybody could be around.
Yeah. Also, I don't really like people, though.
If it's a multiplayer game, they'll each get one Joy-Con, so you have to sit
down. No, I agree. Yeah. I agree, and that's the one thing. I haven't played a lot of multiplayer stuff, so I think the only time I would ever even think about tabletop mode would be in a multiplayer situation. Sure. I plugged it up on my TV, and I played about 5 minutes of Zelda, and then I was like, absolutely, I think it looks horrible on the TV. And no, so
it's so pretty on the TV.
I pulled it off.
Watercolor, it looks great.
I put off the other thing is, so I play on monitors, on 24-inch LED monitors, and they don't have built-in speakers.
Oh, got it. Okay.
So I have absolutely no audio because if the machine is docked, I can't use headphones.
You can use headphones.
Can you when it's docked?
Yeah, that's what I was doing. I had my headphone. I was like really close to the TV, so I couldn't do it.
Oh, that'll actually work then. So I guess I thought I tried it and I didn't. I wasn't hearing anything, but maybe I didn't have it turned up or something.
Can't hear anything we say, Chris.
Yeah, that's probably true too. But no, I mean I have basically like the reason I wanted this console was to play in handheld mode, and it completely delivers. I played it everywhere, and that's the only thing I want to do.
Cool.
So I have a TV right in front of me, and as soon as we get done, I'm going to take my Switch over to the bed, and I'm going to sit in the last night I was sat in this chair looking at this screen with my Switch in my hand,
inch TV playing.
I have a 24-inch LED, and I swear that I was sitting right here playing Zelda in my chair. So that's just how I want to play, man. That's probably
my favorite way to play too, though.
That's the way I am.
Now, Brant, you were saying you actually enjoy the grip, but I mean, you still play in handheld mode, yeah, right? Now, have you tried?
I don't have the money for a pro controller yet, sure, but I can see how it would be better for Zelda. I like an experience like that. If mm-hmm. they released like a Dark Souls like game or Massive or something hardcore,
sure,
I'm just gonna have to break it.
Hardcore,
unless you live hardcore. you're gonna need a pro controller.
Yes.
It was. I like a hardcore experience. I will need to buckle down and buy a controller sometime, but sure, for now it's perfectly fine. Mm-hmm. Doesn't bother me. So
cool. Well, let me ask, what do you think about the split D-pad on that?
Yeah. It's not, I can see how that could be a problem, mm-hmm, but when I run into that down the road, I'm going to buy Shovel Knight probably soon. Sure. So I'll see how that is using it, but it doesn't really, I don't think it'll be a problem. I could be wrong.
So I think I talked about this this was probably the one thing I was worried about, when they announced, the Joy-Cons with a split D-pad, and I instantly had no problem with it at all. I played Shovel Knight, and I was worried that because it didn't feel like a D-pad that I was gonna miss it and it wasn't gonna feel. And I've played Shovel Knight so far entirely using the split D-pad, and it feels perfect. Mm-hmm. No problem whatsoever. I love it. It's great.
Okay. Well, there you go.
Awesome.
And
I do agree with what you're saying, Brant, about the pro controller, about getting it once you need it. Because like my Wii U, I played everything on my Wii U, no problem. But then when I got Ninja Gaiden and I got, you know, Bayonetta, and I got those fast games, I had
a pro controller.
You just have to.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
Yeah.
The reason I got it was because I am planning on doing some Let's Plays, hopefully starting this week. And so obviously it will be docked at that time because I'll have to play through the computer. And so I will want to play with a pro controller while I'm doing that. But not kidding around. I just enjoy playing. That screen is gorgeous, mm-hmm, and yeah, it fits right in my hand, and I will sit right here in this chair with two monitors in front of me, and I will play in handheld mode for an hour tonight before I go to bed. It's just perfect.
Cool. I guess real quick, what about the UI? I mean, it's very clean. The only thing I'm thinking about the UI that may become an issue, once you have more than three or four games, because I mean, it's just like one long list of games, you know,
like
left to right.
PlayStations.
Right. And you know, two or three games is fine because it just moves the newest game, your most recent game to the front. no problem. For me, though, once I start getting more games, especially wanting to get, you know, a bigger SD card and download a lot of stuff, I want folders. Folders would be great. Because then I can have, you know, just here's my indie folders, here's my mainline titles, just, you know, I can break it down that way. But for right now, what it is, I think a good, clean interface is good for early adopters. You know, people that haven't played Nintendo in a while and they're used to something clean. It's a lot better than Wii U.
Yeah. Let me ask, are you with a light or dark theme?
Dark.
Dark.
Yeah.
Zero dark.
Yeah, I went dark too.
I had the light one on there, but I'm like, it's too bright. It's just too white. So I switched to dark.
Yeah.
You can't turn down the brightness, by the way.
Well, yeah.
Yeah. I have my auto brightness on. And it hasn't, I think it stays around 50%. It's fine. So I will say that the most important thing for the UI, which I think they absolutely nailed, is that it's quick.
Mm-hmm.
Like the biggest issue I had with Wii U was everything just felt like it took forever. And even 3DS, even 3DS, like even going to the eShop, like something as simple as going to the eShop on the Switch is really, really quick. And it felt like it would take like 2 minutes on the 3DS to get to the dang eShop. And it's like, I don't even want to buy a game anymore. This is ridiculous. And I know that sounds trivial, but when you're sitting there looking at a screen and like nothing's happening, it's just like loading screens like that there's nothing more frustrating than that. So I think the one thing they needed to nail was that it was a better like operating system, and I think that it's super crisp and super fast, and I do like that.
Awesome. And Brant, what about you, man? Anything else to add about the UI interface?
No, I agree with Chris that they'll add what they need to with folders at a later date.
It'll come. We'll get themes and folders and crap. They're probably selling badges
right now, which is understandable. But it's right now. It's way, way better than the Wii or the Wii U.
Yes.
Yeah, leaps and bounds. So good start there with the UI.
Awesome. Yep, okay. Just kind of tie this whole thing up real quick. I guess a couple of concerns. We've hit concerns that we have with the system. Brant, I guess we'll start with you, man, because I know Chris has a lot. So Brant, do you have any concerns with the system as of right now?
I know. Well, Virtual Console will come. The lack of Bluetooth headphones really bothers me.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's something that they might add on. They should add on later. There was something else I can't think of it right now, but I'm sure Chris will gladly throw that out there. It's not perfect, but it's just we're early adopters, so this is how every new console is, and it'll grow, and I'm not too worried about it, really. Cool. I like what's there.
Awesome. Now for myself, I'm with you, Brant. I think it's a great start. It's a much better start than, you know, like with Wii U and all that stuff. Cause I mean, it's great. It's simple. No real complaints. The only real issue I'm having with mine, I know some people complain about left Joy-Con issues, things like that. I haven't had any of that. It's all working great. My only concern for myself, I don't know about you guys, but if you tried to check the internet speed on your Switch itself, because when I do like network tests on my Xbox, it tells me I'm getting like 60 down, like 10 up, you know, all that stuff, no problem. My Switch, whenever I run tests on it, doesn't matter if I hardwire it or if I do, because I have a USB hardwire LAN adapter, so I use that, or wireless. Either way, it's saying I'm getting like between 8 and 10 down and like 4 or 5 up. Like, I don't know. I have no idea why. It's the only device in my house that's getting terrible internet speed. Yeah, and
that's
I have
how my
no
Vita
idea why.
Is, too. It gets terrible. I don't know if it's just a handheld thing. I don't know how your 3DS is. But
yeah, so I just thought that's the only real concern I have. I thought that was kind of strange because I know when I download like Fast RMX, it's not really a big game. It's less than a gig, but it took forever to download.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, Snipper Clips demo.
So my internet speed, it's terrible internet speed. I don't know why. And we get great internet everything else in the house. Even my phone shows like 70 down, like 10 or 12 up, and like the Switch is just terrible.
Look, to be honest, I haven't even checked it
before.
Can you see what mine says? You can't
really blurry.
See
it. Nope.
It's blurry.
Nope,
I
what
can't
to say,
read
sir.
It.
So yeah, you can't. So I have 26.3 down, and 7.9 up.
And you got really good internet too.
I did a speed test right before we started to make sure that my speed was good. Yeah. I'm pulling 245 down.
Yeah.
and 18 up. So this is going to be 23.
I have no idea why. So I thought that's the only concern I have is that the internet, because I'll talk about this in my review later in the week. But when I play Fast RMX online, it works fine. But every once in a while, there'll be like a car. They'll be like next to me, and I'll just start going. It'll be like jittering, and then he'll just like appear in front of me, and I'm like,
especially with Mario Kart coming out, they got to get that crap fixed.
So I don't know if it's the Switch itself, if it's maybe I've got an old router. I have but even yours, even when I hardwire it, it's still coming in slow. And so
I was worried about the friend code thing, which that's a pain to have to add those. But it isn't as bad. This is my first time dealing with it. Mm-hmm. It isn't as bad as I thought it would be. Like, everybody's handing out their friend codes and I'm adding them. So then they're there. So it's not really as much of a problem as I think most people make it, but still it's an inconvenience that you just can't look people up.
Sure.
Okay, Chris, we're ready for your waterfalls complaints. Hit us.
So I do have a Google sheet. Okay, guys, come
back about 20 minutes.
I'm not going to go.
Although we only have about 5 minutes to wrap this up, but we'll let him go.
I'm not gonna go through that. I will give you maybe a top three issues.
Okay.
Number one, the only one that really matters, was the only thing that I said they had to get right, and they absolutely did not.
That is
game saves. In a nutshell, once again, your game save saves to the internal memory. You cannot put it on the memory card at all. There's no way to copy it over. Mm-hmm. And it is locked to that system, whatever system that you're playing on. Now, the problem with – and again, this is even for the cartridge games that you buy. So I went out and I actually picked up Legend of Zelda physical. Mm-hmm. The reason I did this – was because at the time, I picked it up, I pre-ordered it. And the reason I did this, because at the time, I assumed it would be like 3DS, where I could save it to the card. And that way, if I'm going to play on the living room Switch or whatever the case is, I would just be able to take that card and it would be on there. But if you buy a card, you still do not get a save on that card. It still saves internally to your Switch console. Period. Now, this is problematic for a number of reasons. Josh, for instance, he only has one Switch between his family. Right, Josh?
Right.
You only got one.
It's nice how you can say the profiles for each game. Like, Eli's playing Legend of Zelda 2, and he can switch. That's another positive. But
until he accidentally erases your save file.
And that's what I'm saying. So that's what I'm going to say. So what happens if Eli accidentally picks your profile because maybe he wasn't paying attention? And if you don't have it set to require a password, it doesn't require a password. So now he's loading into your Zelda game, and all of a sudden he's going to start, throwing all of your inventory off of the freaking mountain.
He's not that incompetent.
I'm just saying, or if you think of something, something else, like let's say that you saved, here's a real example. Let's say that you save on Pokemon right before you're about to battle Mewtwo. And then you're like, okay, I'm going to come back to this battle later. And then he decides to play. Mewtwo runs and you're like, crap, I'm never going to get against that
he
again.
He isn't going to be allowed to play it while it's docked. I told him he cannot take it out because it's another issue. There have been reports of the screen getting scratched.
Oh, right, for docking.
I said you cannot, because I'm like handling this like a 16th century Chinese vase putting this in. Like,
I was waiting
to hear what you were come back. I was gonna say a baby. Is he gonna say something like?
I'm just saying for now, just don't take it up now. I don't know. My mind thinks different, but like I said, for now, he isn't going to remove it from the dock until we get a screen protector. Cause I don't want to take that risk. Chris, he's throwing switches all over the,
he juggles them. He's like,
it's fine. So let's get back on topic. So this is a problem. This is a problem for a number of reasons, but I just went through this whole thing and you guys actually watched my evolution, even on the show where I was completely irate when I found out that I was going to lose 90 hours of Animal Crossing because my Nintendo 3DS died.
Almost actually went away from Nintendo.
Like I was on the brink, and to be honest, if I hadn't if I hadn't have invested so much in that machine, I may have just walked away. But I have so much invested in, so I did end up getting a 3DS. But I start all over, yep. You know. And it was it still hits me. The other day, I don't know, 2 or 3 weeks ago, a guy that I work with, Steven, who actually listens to the show. So hey, Steven. So Steven, he's like, oh, let's play Mario Kart. I'm like, oh, I'm the king of Mario Kart. It's going to be great. So we start playing Mario Kart, and I load it up, and I realize I have no cups unlocked. No carts unlocked. I have just the 8 racers that you start with. That's it.
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh my gosh, I can't. Like, I had every cart unlocked and every racer unlocked and every cup unlocked. And I was like, it's all gone. Yeah, and I was so mad.
And Steven's like, hey, Chris, where are you going? And you just go in the corner and you put your head down and you start crying.
Yeah. And so we played and I joked around with him. So I ended up playing Mario with just like a regular cart because that's all I had. And he beat me. And he beat me by like the last race he came in first. And I ended up I got hit with a shell and came in third. And he rubbed it in my face. He wrote it on a whiteboard. And I'm like, dang it. Wait till I get my sub cart back. We're gonna talk. But I have no so just stuff like that. So now we're in the same way. So what happens? So I sent you guys a video where I had to do a hard restart on my Switch on day one.
Right. I had to actually do one too. Not on day one, but this weekend my Zelda locked up and I had a hard reset.
Okay. So we were, and it was just the home menu. And I have this little video. I may just put it up on Twitter just so you guys can see it. I mean, it's nothing special. It's just like it was completely unresponsive. So I had to hold down the power button for whatever, like 10 seconds or whatever.
Yeah, 12 seconds.
And it powers off. That's fine. But now what's going to happen when I put, you know, 80 hours into Zelda and then my screen freezes up? Like,
3DS all over again.
I am going to lose my mind. And if something was to happen to that console, Nintendo tells me, you're out of luck, bud. There's nothing we can do. And that's actually is Mark, a
you're
problem.
Out of luck, come on.
We don't know about cloud saves yet.
No, they still can. So when I was talking about this on Twitter a little bit, and some, you know, a couple people tweeted back out at me, Joey and Sean, and we were going back and forth, but they talked about you know, that other, you know, the other services have, you know, have cloud saves, and it's tied to their Gold or their PlayStation Plus accounts, right? Sure. So that's fine. That may be there. It's not there now. So yeah, I am playing Zelda now. If something happens before Nintendo decides to implement whatever they're going to implement, what happens to my game save? Sure. I understand that life happens, but the fact that Nintendo, we are in 2017, and Nintendo did not have the foresight to think better about this after knowing everything that I went through is mind-boggling to me, and it infuriates me when I even think about it.
But, you know, at Nintendo, and they have their list of things we have to accomplish for the Switch, they probably don't have Make Chris Happy on there.
No, it's not. But it's not even that. It's just like
oh no, Chris White
point,
was mad before. We gotta make sure we fix it. Miyamoto's like, oh no.
At this point, Nintendo has to understand how far behind they are out of the game. And if they want to start being taken serious as an actual, you know, console manufacturer, not a child's toy, they have to start, you know, thinking. And that's what they did. They put adults in their commercials and they made an amazing piece of hardware that looks like something Apple or Samsung would make. Like, it looks good, it feels good, it's solid. And then you launch and with the same stupid issues that are like, oh, we're sorry if our hardware fails and you lose everything that you have. Sorry about that. Mm-hmm. That's not okay. We don't live in an age where that's okay. And it's not about making me happy. It's about protecting you. It's about protecting your consumer. You know, we are buying the product in the hope that we're going to actually have a quality, experience. Right. And that's not what we're having.
Right. Now, I will say I forget which site did it. They did a drop test on the system. They dropped it. They wanted to see how many times they could drop it on concrete before it would actually stop working. And, you know, pretty much all Nintendo products, except for the ones Chris buy, are normally pretty durable. they were able to drop this thing 11 times face down, like they hit every angle on the system from different heights. They dropped it 11 times before it actually stopped working. So, and that's on solid concrete. So, I mean, for something this thin and this flimsy looking, I mean, it held up really well.
But okay, yeah, Chris, my 3DS is in perfectly working condition. Sure. So it had nothing to do with the hardware. I'm just saying this is a problem. And Nintendo has had 6-7 years to fix it. I mean, Microsoft offered cloud saves early in the life cycle of the 360.
Right.
And now we're almost to their third console from the 360.
I bet they're
and
waiting.
Still doesn't do it
for the subscription service because you can only get that through PS3.
Right. A lot of your saves for like things like Miitomo and Fire Emblem and, to my understanding, Super Mario Run, I believe they do have cloud save because they say if you load some other device, it'll work. Okay, Chris, we're way over time on this topic, but you said you had other complaints. You want to hit any more, like just real rapid fire other issues?
No. That's the big one. That's fine.
Okay. You sure? Nothing else? Nothing.
No, I'm probably going to do a show, an off show about
Chris show.
The Chris show starring Chris. And his face goes boot like a Looney Tunes cartoon.
Oh, I'm so tired. Weird. Wow.
Okay. And with that, we will cap off that topic.
But we love it.
But we love it.
We love
yes,
the system.
It is absolutely awesome. And the great thing about the system, we all play different ways. You know, like I said, I love it on the TV. Chris is playing 100% handheld. Brant is jumping between handheld and tabletop. So, I mean, it's great. There's so many options to play, which is awesome. So we hope you have your Switch. We hope you are enjoying it. Okay, guys, now we're going to do our second topic of the week. And with that, I say, hit it, Chris.
When the moon hits your eye like a bigger pizza pie, that's Switch Mora.
That was wonderful.
When it hits your face, you just want to urinate Switch Mora.
a nice duet there. It was beautiful.
Yeah. There we go.
You know, we're going to be talking about a little game called The Legend of Zelda, Breath of the Wild. Now, if you don't want any spoilers or anything like that, stay away. We won't get into too much spoilerish stuff.
Zelda's in it.
Right. I'm surprised you didn't do any kind of Zelda music at all. But you went for the song where people are eating spaghetti and having a good time. Okay. Now,
okay.
There's no words.
Okay.
I'm done.
Now, to kick things off,
we'll never get through this flipping
Brant,
show.
Brant, in our chat, we all start talking about Zelda, how great this game is.
Yeah.
This is, according to Metacritic, it is tied for the second highest scored game on Metacritic overall. It is sitting at a 98% out of 100 on Metacritic. After, you know, I forget how many reviews over, maybe 100 or I forget, however many sites were counted on this. The only game higher than this is Ocarina of Time at a 99%. Now,
that's a different topic.
Right. Now, when we first started talking about Zelda and, you know, how much we loved and how great it was, Brant, you came in and said Horizon Zero Dawn is the better game.
I was enjoying
it. Now, I will say Horizon Zero Dawn sitting at 93%. Now, jokingly, I said, how could you like a 93% more than 98%? But, I mean, we all have our own opinions on what we like more. Now,
most of the time, Josh is wrong.
Josh is wrong, hashtag.
Now, since then, you've come back and you've said, you may have spoken too soon.
Yes.
Now, I guess let's just kind of kick things off with Zelda. What changed your mind? What in this game is opening your eyes to, you know, the greatness that is Breath of the Wild?
Okay. So when I said that, it was yesterday, and I put in a great 5-6 hours of time since then. And I have to say, everything is just, it's just almost perfection. The 98 isn't, you know, it is what it is. It's true. It's like today when I was playing, I threw a bomb at some enemies and he kicked it back at me. How did the enemies it blew up in my face. And with the physics, the physics aren't even touched on to a great extent in this game. And you're given everything you need pretty early on. And so when you get stumped by something and then figure it out, it's like you can find out what it is right there. It's not like go get the grappling hook or whatever. Mm-hmm. So each those shrines that you go into, there's, I guess, over 100, yep. But mm-hmm. they're all perfectly laid out. They're bite-sized puzzle things that you can figure out. And that's what I always had a problem with Zelda. I'm not much of a puzzle guy. And I think they just knock it out of the park as far as that goes. Mm-hmm. The combat in this game is not deep, but it is satisfying and it works. Mm-hmm. It works well. It's so great that they don't even need RPG mechanics because there's so many different ways you can take out the enemies with the physics and having a boulder fall on somebody or roll one or use bombs. And yeah, it's, there's so much to talk about, but early impressions on, I was too quick to say something, and I love this game.
Sure. And actually, before we get any farther, I forgot to ask, kind of let our listeners know, where are you at in the game? Like, have you gotten to like the first dungeon yet? Have you like, where are you? Are you just exploring? Have you not really done anything yet?
Well, that's the funny thing about it. I think we're all at different points in this exactly. game. Like, I'm yes. off doing my own thing on this one side, you're over here completely different, and I haven't even reached Kakariko Village. I've just been going trying to get those things, that trying to open up more of the map, the tower, and everything. Sure. It's probably harder because I'm not further in the story. I don't have a good set of armor, so people can one hit kill me.
Yes.
At times. But that's the great thing about this game, is there's always a solution. Like, I can keep dying and still, you know, figure out what to do, try something different and figure it out and still beat the thing. And plus, they're saying it's like comparable to Dark Souls, which Dark Souls games are my favorite games of all time. It isn't really, from the combat, Dark Souls is much deeper, but it's still just as satisfying. And when you die, it's not like where your souls get left off in a place and you have to go get it. It's just the checkpoint system is great because it auto saves automatically for you and you're never too far back from where you died. So it's hard, but it's not frustrating hard.
Sure.
And so they nail it with that, in my opinion.
It is crazy because as you listen to other people talk about the game, like different websites, different podcasts, they all say the same thing. There are so many, you know, quote unquote, water cooler moments where everybody's doing something different. Everybody has their own experiences. Because for myself, I mean, I'm slowly moving along and I'm kind of just following the story path, right? And I'm climbing those towers as I get to that part in the story where they say, go to this area, do this. Because, you know, eventually, you know, where you get to, you have to go to these different domains, right? To do actual dungeons versus the smaller bite-sized shrines. And right now, I'm in the Zora dungeon. I mean, no spoiler there, obviously. You know, we knew Zoras were going to be in it. And I'm at the tail end of this dungeon. And I, for the life of me, can't figure this stupid thing out. Because it's a giant puzzle, right? And like you said, Brant, it's just one of those things where you're given, like, everything you need within the first couple hours, maybe. I mean, yeah. Because it starts off, you go into the Great Plateau, and you have to do four of these shrines. You have to before you go any farther. Once you do that, the game is just open, and that gives you all the tasks you need. And so I'm moving along in the story. Out. Right. And so I'm at the Zora domain, and you have to activate, I think, like five of these little, you know, tablet stone things. And there's one more I have to find. I found it. I know exactly where it's at. It's on this spinning water wheel, right? And water's making it spin. I can't figure out for the life of me how to turn the water off to get this stupid thing to stop.
But once you do.
Once I do, it's going to be, I mean,
it's going to be like an eye-opening.
Okay, do you do it with the magnet?
And I've tried. Like, I've tried doing the magnet. I've tried stopping time. Because there's another place, I mean, not really spoiler, there's another place in there, because the Zora domain, obviously, is all about water. How to make water stop and start and all that stuff. And you can move different pipes around and things like that. And one of them I had to step on a switch to make water go. So I've been looking everywhere for switches. Can't find a switch. There's one where there's a crank. Can't find any cranks. Like, I'm looking everywhere, and I can't solve it. But it's like, it's the last thing I have to do to totally finish the Zora domain. I've been exploring, but not as much. You know, I just, because if you follow the story, you'll find a horse. You'll go to Kakariko Village. You'll just kind of work your way through it. And that's what I'm doing. So I'm just going the storyline route. I do some exploring because, as you guys know, rupees aren't really a thing. I mean, you don't get them for cutting grass. Yeah. You have to find items and sell stuff.
Yeah.
If I need food or if I need money, I just run out and just start exploring and finding stuff. I'll go every time I go up in one of the tall towers, I use the tablet, right, to look around and pinpoint all the little shrines I can see from the tower. And I try to do those first, and I move on with the story. At least that's the pace I'm taking it. But I guess, Chris, where are you at in the game? How many hours do you think you're into it?
Well, I am I'm currently in Hyrule. So
you've already made the castle, you beat the game, you're done.
Is that spoilers? So I spent most of my time this weekend doing a deep dive on the actual hardware itself, and so I shuffled a lot of games, and so I haven't got to play near as much as I want to. We were talking about this before. I don't even have the glider yet. I'm still working with the old man in the first four shrines. So I'm like, but I probably played for about 3 hours. I probably could have been done by now, but I've done a lot of just messing around too. So I'm on the last of the shrine, and it's up on a mountain where freeze to death.
Right.
So I believe I'm supposed to find a tunic somewhere. So that's kind of where where I am in the game right now. But after I got the first, so the first one is the magnet, right? You can do it in any order.
You unlock all four abilities. You can do them in any order you want.
Right.
Okay. Yep. So I did the magnet one first. So I just spent time just running around, zapping crap with the magnet, and throwing stuff at bogoblins, and just like it's just so great. So again, we're talking spoilers. So as soon as you come down the hill after you get on the Great Plateau, it's the flipping Temple of Time.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I just spent like 30 minutes just walking around trying to see if I could, you know, see anything that reminded me of Ocarina. Dude, you know, it's
when
just like
you first go out, it's like that Fallout 3 moment.
Yeah.
Like how vast it is. It's beautiful.
I've been playing a lot, and I've been climbing mountains. I will tell you that I was scaling this mountain, and I'm afraid of heights, like real life afraid of heights. And I'm playing on this little small handheld screen. And I got a little queasy climbing up the dang mountain.
You can climb anything, which is
just about anything.
But you know, because they give you the stamina meter, you know, it kind of makes the pressure there a little bit. And I'm like looking around. I'm like, oh crap, am I gonna make it to this ledge before I fall off? And it's just like the game is just transformative. Like there's no other experience that I think I've ever had in a game like it. And again, I haven't even scratched the surface, but I just like to run around and just try to get into trouble. I've died a couple of times because this one time I came over a hill, I saw two goblins. I'm like, you guys are mine. So I had this big like hunter's axe whatever.
Yeah, no.
I do have Cabe and my 3-year-old was watching me because they haven't it is pretty hard, so none of the kids have really tried to tackle it yet. My 10-year-old I think could probably play a little bit, but it's a pretty hard game. Like there's a lot of controls and stuff, and but my 3-year-old was watching, and I was cycling through the weapons, and I had a pitchfork. He was like, why has he got a fork? That's not exactly like a fork. It does kind of look like a fork though when you look at the little icon. But I've just been going around, I've been picking up everything I can, and I've already have you guys picked up the skeleton hand?
Yes.
Yeah, that's really cool.
When you're just wearing it, it moves. Yeah.
And on the ground, it moves.
Little things in this game. There is so much care to every little thing. So I like go around. They don't like it. The none of the kids like that the hand moves while I'm running around.
Oh, it's so great.
I always want me to switch the weapon. So I absolutely love it. I mean, as soon as we get off of here, I'm gonna play. And so good. And now that I've done a lot of stuff this weekend, just with like going over the hardware and stuff, it's more about just playing Zelda. So I'm hoping to sink a lot of time into it this weekend.
I thought the stamina bar would be a big problem, like you mentioned, but mm-hmm. it really doesn't hold you back that much. Like, no, you feel like you get enough stamina. Like, I hate games that force you like to manage that.
Yeah.
But right. It's really not a problem.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I'm absolutely loving it. Now, one thing, you know, I was talking with Matt earlier today because he's playing through it a little bit too. He's about where you are, Chris. He's just kind of running around exploring. He's not really out of the Great Plateau yet. He doesn't have the glider thing. Oh, by the way, I was thinking about when you're talking about going up the mountain and finding the clothes to keep you warm. For me, I found hot peppers and I made food and I just ate that because I didn't.
You get a buff for it.
What?
You get a buff for it, right, against yeah. the cold.
Yeah. Right. And so I just ate hot peppers instead and got up the top and finished it. And then afterwards, after I did all that, because I thought that's what I was supposed to do, I found it. Oh, by the way, you can find this armor over here in this one specific spot, which keeps you warm. But I've talked to other people and they said, I didn't know about it either. So yeah, Brant. See, I was going to say, Brant hasn't found it either.
Dude, it's funny because I was.
How did you go up, Brant? Did you do hot peppers too?
Yeah, I cooked the hot peppers because it says, and then it gives you a buff against the cold. That's mm-hmm. the only way I could get to one of the shrines.
Exactly.
Plus, it's funny because I was playing, it's like a real mountain. If you go up into the mountain and it's daytime, it stays a good temperature. But mm-hmm. then when it turned nighttime, it just all of a sudden got cold and I was like, oh crap, I got to get out of here or get in shelter.
No. Yeah, because I mean, I did the exact same thing. That's so funny.
If you guys see the light, I don't know if you guys saw the lightning. Yes. It's crazy. Yeah. Like,
this game is so pretty, guys. Like, it is so beautiful. Like, when the lightning strikes and like sparks, it looks so good.
It's awesome.
Yeah, and if you're wearing anything metal, like a shield or a sword or anything like that, it'll start sparking a little bit because the lightning will just hit you and you're toast.
Even the bombs. When you get the bombs, man, the explosion of the bomb is so satisfying.
It's nice that you don't have like a bomb bag. It's just.
This is your bomb, it's not like a little timer, like a little refill timer, but I love it.
Early impressions of this game, like, you know, none of us are really that far because I haven't beat the first temple yet. You have, you know, Chris, you haven't even found the glider yet. Brant, you're just kind of running all over the place. I talked to Corey from DNA earlier today about his experience with it. And he said what he's doing, he's just been running around fighting all the towers. He isn't doing, he's wanting to unlock the entire map.
He did find an awesome piece of armor, though, which I won't spoil.
Yeah, right. Yeah, I mean, there's just the game is just it's fantastic. Now, one thing I will say, I was talking to my brother-in-law Matt earlier today because he's kind of playing through it. He's about where Chris is. He said, "What do you think about this Zelda game?" And you know, I told him this game is absolutely amazing. You know, I'm loving it. But right now, it kind of reminds me of Hyrule Warriors in a way. And the reason I say this is Hyrule Warriors was a Zelda game, but it was more of a different game skinned with Zelda on it, right? Because I feel like this game is amazing no matter what. This game earns all the 98s it gets, 100%. But while I'm playing it, in a way, it doesn't feel like a Zelda game. Like, it's got the winks and nods, like the Temple of Time and the Zoras and all this stuff in there, but like, there's no real music in it. Right. I mean, and as you guys know, I mean, you don't really, you know, you don't get the green clothes. You don't like it. None of it follows the Zelda formula. It's totally breaking it apart. And in a way, I feel like if it wasn't Zelda, it'd still be an amazing game. Right. And I feel like in a way, it's almost not a Zelda game. Right. I mean, I'm loving it, but like, as I'm playing it, I'm like, sometimes I'll forget it's a Zelda game. I just feel
the
like I'm playing this great
open
world.
The one thing that they added that I don't like about it is mm-hmm. the weapon degradation system
breaks so fast.
Once you get further in, you get better gear that lasts mm-hmm. a little longer, but I don't like how you have to switch weapons. And it's cool that you can throw them for extra damage, but it's just I think it's a little clunky, the systems in place. Like, it doesn't feel like Horizon Zero Dawn just plays absolutely fantastic, like no problems with controls, but this just doesn't feel like there's too much going in and out of menus and stuff breaking that you have to keep swapping in and out. That's my main problem with the game.
Sure.
So,
so I hope, I mean, the collector's edition of this game came with a Master Sword like statue. Mm-hmm. I hope at some point we get the Master Sword. I agree that I'm not a big fan of having the weapons breakdown either. The one thing that does do is it makes you, number one, it makes you more resourceful, but number two, it makes you use other things. Like, I would almost never use an axe in a game. It's just not a weapon that I like to use, but I've been hacking the crap out of things with axes because I got like three in a row, and so I've been axing people to death. So in that perspective, I think it's kind of cool that it's forcing you to try different weapons and different kind of different fight styles. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, an axe takes two hands to swing, and it's slower, you know, than what you would be used to with a sword or a skeleton hand, which is bad A. But I do hope at some point we get a Master Sword because, I mean, you know, Zelda for me is about having the Master Sword and it being like the sword. And so I do hope that comes along. I agree with what you're saying, James, about it not feeling necessarily like a Zelda game. Mm-hmm. Only I would say that it actually maybe does feel like the most Zelda game ever because it feels like an evolution of the original game. Mm-hmm. The original game was an open world where you could tackle anything in any order that you wanted to. Very limited resources, a real difficult game. Like you could die in a heartbeat in that game.
Right.
Nothing really made any sense. Nothing held your hand. So it almost feels like, that's been 30 years. It almost feels like they took that game 30 years later and it's like, well, how do we turn that into a 3D experience? Mm-hmm. And I feel like that's what we're playing. And so while I agree, you know, when people think, you know, Zelda, they probably jump to either Link to the Past or Ocarina, which are both, I think, departures from the first game. And so, you know, maybe this is more Zelda than anything that we've played before. Sure. So.
Someone made a nice analogy that's like if the original Legend of Zelda and Ocarina of Time just went together, had a baby, this was what you would get. A mixture of both.
Yeah,
sure. And I agree. It is a lot so like good. The original Zelda. And maybe that's why it feels so different. I mean, it's taking a lot of ideas from a lot of other games. So, you know, like Skyrim and like, you know, Fallout and like all, you know, all these open world games, well, those aren't great examples by the same company, but you know what I mean? Like they're taking these ideas of all these open world games, like Witcher and things like that.
Well, and throwing it.
Right.
Powers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's an amazing game. Like Nintendo took these ideas everybody else had, put them all together, but it's like the perfect formula. Like this game is just, it's just so good. Like Brant said, it is almost perfect. Like I even called this might be a perfect game. I mean, it's just, it's so good. It is just, so good.
I agree. This really gives me excited for what comes next. Like mm-hmm. I feel like if this is where Nintendo's headspace is and we already see Mario Odyssey and mm-hmm. Mario Odyssey looks amazing. But, like, what are we going to get from Metroid? Mm-hmm. And what are we going to get from an actual real Star Fox game? And, you know, it's just like, I think, like, that's where my mind goes. Like, if we're seeing at the launch of the system, probably the best Zelda game ever made, I'll reserve my statement on that until I beat it. But from everything you're hearing, this game is an absolute masterpiece. Mm-hmm. And that's how you start the console.
Right.
Like what else?
It's only down from here, boys.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. But like, but seriously, like, I mean, if you look at Odyssey looks amazing. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I'm hoping that Nintendo is really focused on, I can't wait to see what Animal Crossing looks like on Switch.
You may actually be able to, like, it'll be a huge world, man. It's kind of like what they did with like City Folk. We could go to the city, but there wasn't really anything there. Maybe they'll like just open it all up. What if Animal Crossing becomes more like The Sims, where you're like in one giant neighborhood, you can just kind of go visit people.
Sure.
So good.
Sure.
Now, one thing I don't know if you guys knew, and I didn't realize either until I heard earlier today, Monolith Soft, the company that made Xenoblade Chronicles and Xenoblade Chronicles 2, they're the ones that helped Nintendo build this open world. And I'm like, that's pretty cool. So they went to another company and said, hey, how do we do this? And I mean, Xenoblade's a huge open world.
All studios.
I wonder, this game is made by the same director that made Skyward Sword, right? And Skyward Sword got a lot of hate. I enjoyed Skyward Sword, but I mean, it got a lot of hate. One of the biggest problems was all the everything was broken into parts, right? Like you'd fly through the sky, you'd fall the hole, and here's a little island. You know, here's another little island. So it wasn't one big open world.
Yeah.
And I wonder if what Breath of the Wild is what the director of Skyward Sword always wanted it to be, but because of the Wii and it just didn't have the power, didn't have the resources, they had to break it up into these loading times. And so maybe this is his vision all along. And I mean, it's amazing. It's an absolutely fantastic game. Like, is there anything else you guys want to add onto our topic of the week?
Well, I'll say that the power, this is probably, there's never been a launch game to buy a system with, but I truly feel
Super Mario 64.
In my limited time. Yeah, but I was just a kid then. I don't even think that game now is a game to buy a system for, but this is the game to buy a system for. No, I'm being dead serious. Like, it's $300 is worth playing this game. If you have a Wii U, play it, and you don't have the money for a Switch, then by all means buy it. But yeah, just buy this system so you can play that game. Because Ben Hasty, one of my good friends who he doesn't play video games much, he actually bought a Switch. And yeah, just to play Zelda. And he just wanted he's doing all the positive buzz from the Switch. So if it can win over people like that, that he doesn't even have a TV, he's just playing handheld all the time too. So it's great. Just buy the system for the game.
Right. This is really interesting because for the first time ever, I can ever remember, maybe since childhood when, you know, everyone just kind of had the same system because there weren't really a lot of options, you know, Super Nintendo, Sega, like that was it. But this is the first time I could ever remember in the history of video games where every single person I know that plays video games bought a Switch. Even those that aren't like super hyped about video games, like I said with Ben, he bought a Switch. Like you know, like all you guys bought them, all the guys you talk with in all the podcasts, all my gaming friends, they all bought Switches.
Now even the Nintendo guys,
it's crazy. Like this system is so hyped. I don't know, at least right now, what the Switch is going to turn out to be. But if it stays this hot and this hyped, it's going to be crazy.
Oh, we didn't even go over the Nindy Showcase.
No.
Yeah.
Like, all those games coming out.
Yeah.
If they're packing in this game with plenty of games we can play right away while we wait for the big stuff, which is they have a plan in place anyways for that. So
to be honest, what else are you gonna play? I mean, come on. Every time I look at Shovel Knight, Switch. I love Shovel Knight, but every time I look at Shovel Knight, I'm like, I think I gotta play Zelda. So I will say this. And I think this is a record. This is the first time that we've all actually agreed on something. So
right.
That's
yeah.
but
it's totally
no, Chris's just,
fault. Just for the record.
Just in final thought. This is a game that we talk about a lot. You know, I told you today, you know, I walked into church and we had that, you know, that moment that I shared with my friend where I hold up my case and he holds up his. You know, it's like that longing. It's like, oh, we're soulmates. And we just stood around and talked about Zelda. And every time I think that I'm overhyping it, I play it again.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just blown away again. Yes, and even like right now, like I'm talking about it with you guys, and I'm thinking in the back of my mind, I'm like, I mean, is it really that good? But I know as soon as I put my headphones on and I launch the game, it's just amazing. Like it is a brilliant game. It's a masterpiece. It's so great. So.
It, And honestly, the only thing I'm worried about, I mean, I'm playing the story right now, right? But as of right now, this game, it really lives up to all those perfect tens. I mean, it is, like I said in the chat between us, like, it, I feel like it might be a perfect game. Like, it is just, at least for where we are in video games right now, of course, video games can always get better. But at this point in time, it's like, it's the perfect game. And it's, yeah, like, I can't even put into words, man. It's just that good. I can see, you know, with how long the game is, because I think Jose Otero over at IGN said it took him, like, what, 40, 50 hours to get to the main story. So, I mean, that's a pretty good chunk of time. And I thought, man, that's going to take me forever to get through. But this game is just, it's so good. It, like, calls you. It's like, play me. Like, there hasn't been a game like this in so long. And I just keep putting more and more time into it. And the Switch is smart, as it doesn't have a little meter on there to tell you how long you've actually been playing. The parental app, if you download it, that's the only way to see how much time you're putting into a game. So I have no idea exactly how much time I put into it, but I'm like, yeah, 40 hours, no problem.
Yeah.
Brant, any final thoughts?
No, I made my case for it. I agree with what you guys are saying, and I'm really happy with the start, Nintendo's. I hope that all their major franchises turn out near as good as this. I don't think they'll be as good as this, but
yeah.
It's going to be fantastic. There's like no, I mean, it's the Switch overall as a whole is going to have an amazing first year. We don't know what's coming in the future, but like with the indie showcase, what they showed, you know, maybe we'll hit that next week, because I mean, there were more games hyped for that. Like when they showed it, I thought it's going to be the same old stuff we already know about, but it was exclusive after exclusive after exclusive, whether it was timed exclusive or exclusive content or a full on exclusive. It was crazy. So, you know, all that stuff is coming. You know, we know Mario Odyssey is coming. Like, we're getting the great, maybe the greatest Zelda game ever made, and maybe the greatest Mario game ever made in the same year. And that doesn't count Splatoon and Mario Kart and, you know, Xenoblade and all these fantastic games. It's going to be a great year. I mean, we go to the end of this year and look back, it's going to be interesting.
This might be the best year ever in gaming, from the Sony side. I mean, the exclusives they're bringing out, and then this, come on.
Yeah. It's so good. Okay, guys, we hope you enjoyed this topic of the week. We are absolutely loving our Nintendo Switches. And honestly, once we get out of here, I think we're all going to go right back to Zelda. But as for now, you know, if you want to find us, our podcast on most weeks goes up every Sunday on iTunes, SoundCloud, and the Google Play Store. So make sure to find us there. Go on there, rate us, comment. It'd be absolutely awesome. We'd love hearing from you guys. And, you know, if you want to talk to us, you can always find us on Facebook at Life of Gaming. We're also on Twitter at Life of Gaming Pod and on Twitch, Life Gaming Pods. Make sure to check us out there. Hopefully we'll have a lot of awesome Zelda live streams coming up. Show you some cool stuff there. As for myself, you can find me on Twitter and Twitch and everywhere, Jamester0722. Now that I think about it, I'm going to pull up my Nintendo Network ID friend code. So if you want to find me on the Switch, look up 5642-7363-5031. So if you want to find me on the Switch, type that into the little find your friend code, you know, whatever it is. So check that out. Mr. Brant, where can people find you?
On Twitter, you can find me at minus the Brant, MINUSTHEBRANT. That is also my PSN ID and my Switch name. I'm not going to spell out my...
No! ruined it.
My ID, but you can message me and I will give that to you.
There you go.
So, yep.
He's just too lazy to look it up. Okay, Chris, I am. What about yourself, man?
So you can follow me at NeoLego. That's where you're going to find pretty much anything that I have to say. And you can get to all of my other stuff there as well. And my Nintendo Switch friend code is S as in Sam, W as in Walter, 6695-0237-2505.
Boom. Now, so Brant, you are really left out. You're the only one without the friend code. So no one wants the friend Brant anymore.
Hey, I have all my people out of this.
That's right. Okay,
there
guys.
There's only a 300 friend limit, so if you want to get on that list, you better jump on it.
We hope you guys enjoyed another wonderful week of the life of gaming. We have so much to talk about in future shows, especially with all the Switch content, amazing PlayStation content, and we've got Mass Effect coming out soon, and all the, it's just going to be a great year. But okay, guys, until next time, we are out.
Bye.
Bye.
We hope you enjoyed this content from the life of gaming. If you like what you saw, be sure to subscribe down below. You can also catch our weekly podcast every Sunday on iTunes, SoundCloud, and the Google Play Store. You can find us on Twitter, at Life of Gaming Pod, and on Facebook. Until next time, we are out.